Welcome back to phase two of the Battle of Philippi. We're going to get set up here for the Confederate counterattack that's going to be coming. I like to set both of my artillery pieces back here into the town so they can support with canister fire whenever anybody charges in. I will be moving Walton out of that position. I do not like that fortification that's close to the railroad tracks there. For one, it stretches you out to where you can end up having that one unit fighting multiple other units. And any of your units that are behind them can't support unless it's an actual charge until they get into range once they've engaged. So don't like having anybody out there. I'd rather have my guys set up in town. I will be using both of the fortifications that are in the town, though, because those will not block your other units from the ability to engage incoming units as they're charging in. The Confederacy does tend to like to attack any unit that's in that northern fortification, so we're going to put one of our skirmishers up there in that area, and then we're going to put another skirmisher into the wooded area just behind it, as well as having support from the north part of the town. Again, like my previous phase one, I won't be speaking through this entire thing. I'll turn up the game volume when I'm going to sit back, and then anytime I have something to say, I'll go ahead and turn it down and add some commentary. When we get to the first camp after this battle, I'll go over a few changes that I've made to the mod files, as well as go over things that you might want to change in your own battles. However, pretty much none of those changes affects the Battle of Philippi. This battle cannot be scaled up or down. It's pretty much hard-coded to be what it is, so you shouldn't have to worry about anything that you do in your mod files affecting this battle at all. And if you do change things in a mod file and then wondered why didn't they show up here? It's because Philippi is pretty much non-scalable, so you won't see those types of things here. So we have our reinforcements coming in. These are normally 1 3-star and 2 2-star units, along with whatever you get for the artillery, which are usually ordnance rifles. Again, you should always check out what your unit perks are on your allies, because they can influence how you're going to use them in the battle. This is just for me. You know, other people do their own thing. But when I check these guys out, you know, anybody that has 2 speed perks, I'll go ahead and run them just about all the way up to the battle. Because the additional speed, they really don't lose that much condition in order to get up there. And I can always rest them for a couple of minutes in the background before they have to get into the battle. If a unit has 1 speed perk, I'll walk them about half the way and then have them run for the last part. And if a unit doesn't have any speed perks, I pretty much walk them the whole way. You usually don't have time with the artillery to cross any of the bridges to get them into the town and set up before the train shows up with the dry land Merrimack. So I usually set them up outside of town, close to the river. And since they're ordnance rifles, I mean, they're designed to shoot shell anyway. I do make a mistake here and kind of forget about Schultz a little bit, so I never do get him set up to where he would normally be. The one unit here has got a horse artillery perk, so he's moving along quite a bit faster than the rest. So with the horse artillery perk, you can cross one of the bridges and get them over into the town before the train shows up. So unit condition and morale have a huge impact on the game for the JMP mod. You do not want your guys to be fighting with low morale or low condition. With low condition, you have some things that go against you as far as their ability, and you'll get chopped up pretty good if you guys have low condition. With low morale, just determines basically how soon before that unit is ready to rout. And if you hit zero morale, then the game starts to do a check for whether that unit will shatter or whether they will surrender. The base, the way it's set up for the mod right now, is you hit zero morale and you have a 19% chance to shatter and a 15% chance to surrender. And the game will keep making checks as long as you stay on zero morale until one of those things happens. Or you get away and then your unit can recover morale. This particular playthrough, the Confederate units are a little less charge hungry. I mean, they seem to gang up on that left side of the town quite a bit. These units over here on the right, Ellis, Hatch, Grant, they kind of just hang out over there on the right side for quite a while. Eventually, other Confederate units that once they give up charging to the one side of the town, they'll come over there to the right and join them and then kind of do a mass assault, which is one of the reasons why Zook is sitting on that corner, because it seems that usually when there's an overwhelming charge, it's coming from that direction. And because Zook is usually your two-star unit that's left over from the beginning of the battle, he's usually in the best position to try to hold some of that off. The way this goes, I'm able to put him in the fortification and fend off some of those charges the way it plays out. And since you can't change anything in the mod files that affect this battle for scaling, the outcome is pretty consistent. If you wait for the reinforcements to come in phase one like I did, you'll end up fighting about 18,500 enemy troops. If you end Philippi early and don't wait for those reinforcements, then it's around 16,500. The rewards from spoils of war are pretty consistent for this battle, unless you've captured a lot of units. So that'll wrap up this episode, and next I'll get into some of the unique features of the mod, how you can modify certain aspects, and what my plan is to take 12 two-star units into Shiloh. So I'll see you then.